When it comes to the question of who exactly Noah was, we summarize the fact that he was the builder of the ark that saved humanity during the Great Deluge. But where did he come from? Where did he go? And more importantly, who was Noah? Wait, do you hear this? Noah was considered by God to be the only living patriarch worthy of God's trust. This was a time in human history that is widely regarded as a time of great evil spreading across the earth. He preached for 100 years during the building of the Great Ark, and God patiently waited for any person to repent. However, no one believed Noah or wanted to follow the God. Noah was a beacon of hope among the descendants of Adam in an area where sin and lawlessness had overtaken the people. Mankind had been one community believing in the oneness of God, but confusion and deviation had crept in. Noah was a calm, patient man who called his people to return to the worship of the one true God. He was an inexceptionable speaker, enjoining those around him to leave the worships of idols and to hear his warning of a terrible punishment. And it was eventually judged by God, or the Anunnaki, as we may be referring to here, that a cleansing of the earth was required, hence the flood. What if the Ark was a doomsday vault, much like the one that is hidden deep in the permafrost in Norway? All the seeds and DNA are stored away there safely in case of cataclysm. Maybe Noah was responsible not only for building the Great Ark, but also for preserving all life. Animals, plants, humans. Makes sense, does it not? After the flood, it was the sons of Noah who are said to have recovered the depleted civilization. The sons of Noah who came out of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. There were the three sons of Noah, and from them came the people who were scattered over the whole earth. Exactly when Noah lived is again a sign of hidden history. Education tells us he lived around 5,000 years ago, despite the fact that the Great Flood took place at least 12,500 years ago. The timeline of these events that we are told about in books makes no sense. They literally must have pulled a number out of thin air, simply because they never knew the real timeline. But when you stitch together the stories from around the world with the truth about history, then a clear story begins to emerge. A story that does not need to be overcomplicated in any way. Yet, we are led on a path of confusion from the cradle to the grave. Is this to suppress the truth? You have to wonder. In some ways, it seems that there is a lot more that we don't know about these events than we do know. This can be intriguing, frustrating, and exciting all at the same time. The Gospel of John closes by stating, "And there are also many other things which, if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written." Amen. Yet the Vatican is having a good go at keeping all these books. How can every culture from all over the world be wrong as to the occurrence of such an event like the flood? In China, they refer to Noah as Fuhi and consider him the father of their civilization. Babylon refers to him as Ut-Nasfatim, and India its Manu. Australian Aboriginals tell tales of the Dreamtime Flood, and even the Delaware Indians tell of a time when the world lived at peace, but an evil spirit came and caused a great flood. It's crazy, guys, and this is not even scratching the surface. Every single civilization on Earth tells similar tales of a flood that they always refer to as the displeasement of the gods, and always talk of a man and his family that are almost always identical to the story of Noah. So the story of Noah undoubtedly must be an accurate reference to actual historical events. It is impossible for it to be anything else. The Dead Sea Scrolls even mentions Noah many times. Noah is also a highly important figure in Islam and is seen as one of the most significant of all prophets. The Quran contains 43 references to Noah, or Nu, in 28 chapters, and the 71st chapter is named after him. His life is also spoken of in the commentaries and in Islamic legends. Noah's narratives largely cover his preaching as well as the story of the deluge. Noah's narrative sets the prototype for many of the subsequent prophetic stories, which begin with the prophet warning his people and then the community rejecting the message and facing a punishment. According to Zachariah Sitchin's translation of Sumerian tablets, he says Noah's name was Zarathustra and was the son of Enki, the Anunnaki lord of the earth who created humans with his half-sister Ninma by a human female. According to the Book of Enki, Enki was forbidden from letting the humans know of the impending cataclysm or from saving them. Some of the Anunnaki, Enlil in particular, felt that the humans were a violation of nature and that they had messed with fate by creating us. So the flood would be a great way to undo this mistake. Enki did not want to see his creation be erased, so after it had been decided that the Anunnaki could not warn us, Enki got around it by going to his son Noah's reed hut and telling the wall of the hut about the flood and saying he would leave a tablet with instructions on building a boat that would allow survival of life. Noah hears this, and when he asks the details, Enki said, "I'm not speaking to anyone in general. I am only speaking to the wall of a reed hut." It is largely unclear where Noah emerged from. He lived for 950 years, according to the accounts in the Bible, and after the flood, he spent his time managing a vineyard. What do you guys think of Noah? Who was he? How did he live for 950 years compared to Moses' 120 years? Is he the most important man to ever live? By the way, the Bible also warns us that a second judgment is coming, this time by fire. You have to wonder what path humanity is on at the moment, right? Anyway, guys, comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.